Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great honor to have here Professor Rachel Cranton. She's professor of economics at Duke University, and she's currently visiting professor at the Department of Economics at Sciences Po in Paris. So first of all, really welcome to the UI.
Thank you, it's a pleasure.
And thank you for being here. I would like to start really from a very broad and general picture of your research. So you studied how institutional and social settings, so the social context and the social environment where people live in, affect economic outcomes. And you develop your research, I could say, mainly on two lines, on two perspectives. So on the one hand, you studied network theories and group formation. And on the other side, you investigate the role of identity and social norms in shaping individual decisions. And I would really like to start from this point because I find it fascinating. Mm-hmm. And to start from the fundamentals. So mm-hmm. How could you define identity? How is it connected to social norms? And mm-hmm. from an economic point of view, why bringing identity and social norms into the economics literature is important to, for a better understanding of the process of individual decision making?
Okay, well, thanks. So first, it's interesting that you started with also noticing this other aspect of my research, which is networks. And so some people think that networks and identity are these two lines of separate research, but it's all about the same issue, which is trying to understand human beings as making decisions. So we want our models of economics to be populated by human beings. Yeah. And human beings live in communities. Human beings are social, right? And those aspects have been largely missing from economics, or at least were when I started doing my doctoral research many years ago. So the objective of this research is to have these characters that populate our models to reflect people in real places making real decisions, surrounded by friends and family and colleagues, in a nation state and so on. So to your question precisely about what is identity, so identity is an individual's sense of how they fit or how he or she fits within that social space. So we can look around us and in any setting we might find a human being, again, there's human beings in a society, and that society has certain notions of this person versus that person, a mother versus a father, a president versus their underlings, a student versus a professor. And how does that individual understand his or her position within this social space? And that position comes along with norms for how people should be interacting. So professors and students should be interacting in a particular way, and there's particular ways in which we expect people to behave. And so and you start to feel strange if you don't behave in that way. So identity becomes important for decision-making and economic decisions. Because of those norms and how we feel that we should be acting according to who we think we are or who we understand ourselves to be.
So do you perceive a difference compared to the general kind of notion of preferences?
Yeah, so I think we struggled with this a lot, my co-author and I, George Akerlof. We struggled with a lot to how to explain the difference between what we're talking about, which are norms, versus the preferences, which are typically used in economic theories of choice. And I think we settled on the following, and hopefully it works, is that we typically think of preferences as things that people like. I like bananas, I don't like oranges. So they're likes. The norms, however, are about shoulds, what I should be doing. I should eat a banana, I should eat an orange. And once we introduce that difference, then we can have a trade-off between what I like and what I should. So I may like certain things, but I should not do them because of the norms that by which my society is defining for me and for others within the society. So I think that distinction is rather helpful because what you like may be just something individual about you, but what you should do and how others should be behaving towards you, or how they're allowed to behave towards you, is more or less defined within the society.
Yeah, so it's something basically that is internalized by people in regardless of what they prefer to start with.
Right, okay. Right. And some historians might argue that there is no such notion of likes either. You know, you're somehow taught to like an orange versus taught to like an apple.
Okay.
Right. But, you know, we can argue about the boundary of how far these things extend. But I think that's a useful distinction.
Thank you. And, to be concrete, you gave already some examples. I was always start thinking about identity in terms of gender or in terms of racial identities or racial differences. But the concept you are setting is much more general. So could you give us an example of identity and social norms, how would they affect some economic incentives, and potentially how policies may take those dimensions into account?
So that's great. So when, again, the things that come to mind are, again, very obviously gender and race. So once you talk about identity, people say, oh, of course, you know, gender norms, or racial norms, or racial divisions. But this is a ubiquitous notion. It's everywhere. And once you open your eyes to it, of course you see it everywhere. So I just gave the example of professors and students,
yes.
Right? There's obvious ways in which we should be interacting with one another. But to your question about, say, how this affects decisions, can I point to decisions and policies? One of the settings that one could look at, which doesn't seem obvious at first, but then once you talk about it, of course identity plays an important role, is, say, schooling in high schools and middle schools and so on, where the children, the adolescents, are all trying to figure out who they are, in some sense, in their social space, right? Yeah. And who they are can be more or less attached to school. You know, are they engaged in their schoolwork? Are they not engaged in their schoolwork? So there's plenty of studies of United States schools. Anthropologists have studied schooling within the United States, and there's these typical groups called the jocks, and then there's the burnouts, and they come in various names. But the distinction is that some set of students is very engaged in school or in sports in the US context, since others are less so, they want to party, and so on. So what are the policies? Well, there's clearly school policies that address, or addressed might be too strong a word, that are dealing within that social space. So what the school does in terms of promoting sports clubs, for example, or having rules for certain kinds of participation in school activities, those are dealing with the social space. They're not ignoring it. They're not pretending it's not there. Their understanding of adolescence is much richer than the typical model we might have in economics, which is about, well, I study in school, and there's an opportunity cost of my studying in school vis-a-vis my future wages. Just sort of this, again, this very bare bones model of education. But that's not what a 16-year-old is thinking about necessarily, or a 14-year-old, a 13-year-old. And so the administrators of the school would be working within that social space and thinking very, hopefully, thinking pretty critically about how to, you know, construct their curricula and their clubs and their schools within that setting.
And let me say, in light of your findings, what areas of research do you need more in need for further analysis? And I could like to know your opinion regarding the importance of understanding the mechanism. So I'm mainly thinking in dynamics terms. What are the mechanisms that sustain identity and social differences in the long run? And how much do we need?
So it's a great question. I think we are in a very large need. Okay, it's hard to, you know, weigh what is most important. But I think what is very important to understand is how identities or these norms emerge and evolve. Okay, so how do we understand that process? And so we can look around us and we can see, again, historians and anthropologists have provided, you know, they have studies, for example, social movements, feminist movements, the movements that we're seeing now going on, you know, Me Too or whatever, the equivalent, I don't know if there's one in Italy, but there's some in France and so on, the Me Too movements. There's social movements that, you know, change the way we understand how men and women should be interacting with each other, for example. There's also people who take very prominent roles in changing the social space, or manipulating social space. So think about that school administrator. Some are particularly talented at figuring out how to work within that space and then change, you know, in their own little environment, you know, how the children, you know, interact with each other and with the teachers and so on. But I don't think we have a good theory of that. I don't think as economists we have very good understanding of where do the norms come from, where do identities come from, how they evolve over time with the different forces that come into play. There was a second part to your question. So it was about...
No, it was mainly
the... Okay.
Can I ask something more? Like, always, I'm mainly studying cultural transmission, so I'm always thinking about this persistence in the long run, so this kind of resilience, you know. But you show some example of evolution in social context. Do you think that it's the same? So there is a very strong resilience, but we have examples of evolution, or...
That's a great question, because I think we see both. I think we see resilience of norms, but I also think we see norms changing, right? And I think the jury is out, so to speak. I don't think we know. So for example, if we look at gender norms, we can see that gender norms change pretty quickly in response to a need. So if we see that women's labor is required for a war effort, then, okay, we see all of this propaganda, you know, women working in factories and so on. In the army, a United States example, when the army needed labor, then it became an integrated army, and the norms within the army are actually very different than the norms outside the army, right? In terms of, you know, you get the job done, you're a valued member of that particular unit. You can even see these the difference in sort of racial relationships, so to speak, in the kids. In army bases. So it's really quite striking. So in that sense, yes, we see these changes. On the other hand, well, maybe it took us a very long time to get to that place that we had an integrated army. You know, there were other times when the labor requirements were very high. So there's both a sort of a path dependence, but then there's also perhaps shocks to the system that make things change. And I think it's actually important to understand the role of individuals, or I'll call them maybe identity entrepreneurs in this. There's people that come out with new ideas. There are people that write books, and sometimes these books, for example, will take, will wake people up to particular situations. Or there might be events that happen. And then particular people might capitalize on those events. So there's a room also for individual agency in the change of norms. So it's not just an evolutionary process, you know, but there's also room for individual action. And we don't have, again, I think, our modeling, we're getting there. I can point to a few models that are sort of trying to, you know, chip away at this. But I would think that this, in theory, for the theory side of this enterprise, is a direction to go. I do think empirical work would also be extremely useful, helps guide the theoretical work. So some of these different changes in norms that have happened over time, we're starting to see some empirical studies as well.
Okay. No, I never thought about this individual dimension. I always look at the society in terms of more in collective terms, but that's true, there is a role for individual per se. And I think that the norm, the concept of identity is inherently related to group formation and group belongings, with the idea that if you are part of a certain group, this basically prevents you to be part of the opposite group. And do you think that this creates basically an interaction between identity and inequality, maybe in terms of social inequality? So I'm thinking more to social differences and potential discrimination or lack of integration of minorities, those are topics that we see now.
Right, I think it has to. Right, I mean, some of the, you know, you just look at, again, you just basically look at human history, and certain people were not even understood as people, right? So there were certain people by the color of their skin or by their religion were not understood as equal to another set of people, and they felt, therefore, they could subjugate them, extract labor from them, etc. So in the sort of the very strong historical examples of inequality. Now, if we sort of fast forward to perhaps today, in a modern democracy, do I think these forces are still important? I think the answer again is yes. So to what extent is another person considered like me or not like me? You know, part of my group, somebody that I feel I should be looking out for? And I do think you know, that those notions do matter. And there's a lot of empirical studies in economics, for example, that show that a more ethnically diverse community will have lower expenditures on public goods, for example. So it's not exactly inequality, but it's very close. Right? So the extent to which I'm willing to pay to educate somebody else's child, okay, that's a public good, you know, an education. That's going to matter for inequality, because if that child doesn't get an education, you know, then they're not necessarily going to perform well in the labor market. So again, I think the answer is yes. I think we have a good understanding of inequality and economic growth. We have a lot of studies of those. But to bring in identity as a force, again, it's not clear that we have that. Again, it's starting. It's all starting. But that would be, I think, an extremely important area of investigation.
As a future dimension for inequality research to go?
I would hope so.
Okay.
I certainly hope so.
Okay. And we were talking a little bit about group, let's say, groupiness. And this is something that you are talking about during the Max Weber lecture. Could you give us a definition of groupiness, something you define, let's say? And could you briefly summarize the contribution of the experiments that you will present later, especially in comparison to previous lab experiments and to
the
results?
Right, great. That's a big question, but let me try and take it step by step. So the first is, what do I mean by groupiness? So I think a working definition may not be the most elegant, is that groupiness is a tendency for an individual to feel a part of a group. Okay, so some people, you put them in a situation where there are different groups, and some people will have a greater attachment to that new group, or with the group that they're in, the greater attachment to being a part of a group. So it's the tendency to feel yourself as part of that group. Okay, so that's groupiness. I mean, the discovery of this set of experiments is that groupiness, first of all, that there might be such a thing as groupiness. So going back to the history of experiments, there have been a set of experiments, lab experiments and pseudo-field experiments, where in a lot of the social psychology literature, and then now in the economics literature, where participants in these experiments are divided into groups, and they're asked to perform some sort of task. And then the finding is that a participant would treat somebody in their group differently than they treat somebody out of their group in that task. Okay, and then you see that on average. It's a very robust finding. And we originally wanted to see whether this in-group bias was stronger for people who identified more strongly with the particular group that they were in. And it turns out that we found something surprising, is that there are some people for whom these groups don't matter.
At all.
Yeah. Right, and that was a bit of a surprise. Because when you look at the literature, you see, well, you know, you just see this very robust finding of this in-group bias. But now we found a set of people, very identifiable people, that don't seem to react to being in a group, either a very arbitrary group or even something that might seem a little bit more salient, like political parties. And it turns out that, so this is a surprise relative to my agenda, of course, because I thought identity was so important. And indeed, I still believe it is, but it may be, and I'm now, the more I think about this, obviously, for some people, their identity in their group and part of being a part of a group would be extremely important. It defines who they are. But for other people, it might not. And that tendency, which we're calling groupiness, could be something about the individual. It could come from their upbringing. Right? So it's not just you're born this way. It could be that you're born this way. It could also come from your upbringing, something about your family, something about the environment in which you grew up, something about the experiences you had when you were a child. But when we observe people at, you know, as participants in the experiments, there's quite clearly people who do not seem to respond to the experimental condition of being put in a group. They don't. And so I'm finding that fascinating. So then the agenda is to figure out what's going on here. You know, who is like who, you know, what are those lists of things that I gave you? How are they correlated or not with, you know, with this groupiness or not groupiness, actually, the not groupiness trait? And even in our experiments, we're finding something quite interesting, is that somebody is more likely to be not groupy, to not be groupy, if they have a very highly educated father.
Okay,
so what's going on there? Is it, these are very special, it's one of these experiments in a very special population of students on an American campus, but maybe it's an income effect. Richer people who are more privileged are less likely to be groupy. It could be a transmission of a value effect, but empirically we're seeing there's a correlation. And I could leave some of the other correlations for the lecture this afternoon.
Okay. Now, I remember that I was reading the last paper.
Mm-hmm.
You said before that you try to identify those people, so based on demographics and characteristics. And what I find fascinating is that for a long list of demographics, it seems that there is no correlation at all, so those people are not different compared to the groupy people, but they differ a lot in terms of political participation and political affiliation.
Right, so I will call that a correlation. So what
yeah.
I would say that that's a bit of external validity of our finding within the lab. So in the lab we find there's a set of people who we put them in a group and they don't act differently towards somebody who's in their group versus somebody who's outside of their group. And we look at that person outside the laboratory and this person has decided not to be in a political party. Okay? So this person may have exactly the same political positions as somebody else, but they've decided not to call themselves a Democrat. So they've chosen not to be in a group. So it makes sense that the same person who has chosen to remain independent in a political environment might also be the same person who, they don't like being in groups. It's just not something they find pleasant, perhaps. It's actually interesting, there's a couple of people in our experiment who seem to react, against being in a group. They want to, they treat the out-group better as if they're kind of reacting as, why'd you put me here? And of course, I don't know. I don't know what they're thinking. But these same people, again, there's a correlation.
Yeah.
So I think that's telling us that, there is something to this not groupy versus groupy distinction between individuals. That's not just a lab artifact.
But this correlation is particularly strong for political affiliation, while not for
right.
religious affiliation. For
well,
example.
So the religious affiliation, that's interesting. So religious affiliation, we just asked religious service attendance.
Okay. So,
religiosity. It was religiosity more than Catholic versus Jewish versus Buddhist. So it's so up to the extent to which church attendance, or actually, when do you say church? Attending religious services.
Yeah.
So that's the question. So I imagine that there's other correlates. We did not manage to capture them in the questions we asked, right? So what we were also doing this in an American context, and which is a rather mild context. We do have another correlation in the American context, though. It's a regional difference. So Southern Republicans are less likely to be not groupy. How's that?
Okay.
Yeah, so more likely to be groupy. Right. And so we're getting something about economic conditions. Again, this is in an NTURK survey, so I don't want to make too much of it. But I think if you ask a direction to go, and this is a direction that I'm very committed to, is to trying to understand this groupy versus not groupy distinction, the demographics, to understand the demographics better, to have a better measurement of this trait. Right now, I don't know a great way to measure this trait, and also to understand perhaps what makes somebody groupy versus not groupy. Is there some mechanism behind that? Something about their upbringing, like the cultural transmission from their parents,
yeah.
some value
okay.
which they may have received when they've grown up.
And you were saying, in terms of direction, and especially in terms of method, where do you think that this research needs to go somehow? So experiments are a key, or?
That's a great question. I think experiments, I guess I'd also say, we don't really have a great model of this right now. So when I'm writing down my experiments, I should have a better model to guide the experiments. And empirics, again, to the extent possible. So I'm not an empirical researcher, but I'm stunned at how clever empirical researchers can be by uncovering a natural experiment. So it'd be very interesting to see if, for example, a community growing up under one environment and then there's like a time break. So we're starting to see some of these interesting experiments, right? Where people are subject to a particular educational system and then a different educational system across 1 year because of a change in the political regime, and we observe them, when they're in their 50s. So to the extent that which we can see how natural experiments might be changing people's groupiness, that would be fascinating. I'm not sure that's been the outcome of interest as of yet, but it would be really interesting to see.
Thank you.